Welcome to the Say Practice Matters. It's a fantastic series. It's been put together, and Sue-Ann set this up a couple of years ago. We've had some fantastic people this year. There's been a fantastic group of people speak to us, and they've all been great women architects, and it's been a great privilege actually to sit down and listen to that, which we often don't get a lot of. So that's great. I would like to also acknowledge the land of the Awabakal and the Warramai people whose lecture this takes place, and we respect and recognise their cultural heritage, beliefs and continuing relationship to the land. They are proud survivors of 200 years of dispossession. We reiterate our commitment to address disadvantage and attain justice for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people of this community. It's a great sentiment, and again, perhaps when we start to plan our buildings throughout not only Newcastle but in other places, but because we're in Newcastle and we're talking about the Awabakal and the Warramai, perhaps look at some of the principles that those people had toward the land every time we put pen to paper, I think is a great thing to look at. Our sponsors, which of course we couldn't do without, HDC, BKA Architecture, Hebel, Nagisa for the wonderful food, the lockup for where we are, Marline, Graphisoft, Building Services Engineers. And if I'm squinting as I'm saying, it's because Emma has written this, and it's just like a scrawl. There is a short bio, and it's on the other side of the page. I'm sorry for this glare. So, fantastic. We can, I can introduce our speaker, Laura, who completed an architecture degree at Sydney University in 1988. And has worked with the Sydney-based practice Hill Thalis and Urban Projects since 1996. During her 20 years at Hill Thalis, she has worked on a diverse range of architectural and urban projects, including the winning entry in the international design competition for East Darling Harbour, Barangaroo in 2005, Studios 54, which received the Aaron Bolot Award for Multiple Residential Design in New South Wales in 2015, and Lennox Bridge Portals, which was awarded state and national AIA awards for urban design in 2016. Laura regularly participates in design juries at Sydney University, University of Technology Sydney, and the University of Newcastle. Oh, sorry, New South Wales. She taught in Professor Glenn Murcutt's third year architectural design studio at the University of New South Wales from 2006 to 2012. Laura's architectural writing is regularly published in Architecture Australia, the official magazine of the Royal Australian Institute of Architects, and she was a contributing editor from 2006 to 2013. She has contributed reviews to Architecture Review Australia, Landscape Architecture Australia, Monument Magazine and Houses Magazine. She has also had reviews published in the Saturday paper. What's the Saturday paper? The Herald?
It's a Melbourne paper, which you should read.
And it is called the Saturday paper.
It's called the Saturday paper.
It's exactly as it is. Okay, it's exactly as it is. And The Guardian Australia, and written essays for several architectural monographs. She received the Adrian Ashton Prize for Architectural Criticism in 2013. It sounds wonderful, and I really look forward to you speaking, and thank you again for making the travel to us this evening. Thank you.
I'm really grateful for the opportunity to speak tonight, and I'm very conscious I must be speaking to the craziest people in Newcastle because you're here instead of at the beach, but I'm really grateful, so thank you. When I first read Sue-Ann's email inviting me to talk in this series, I just experienced sheer terror because I hate public speaking, and my favourite place to be in architecture is silently buried inside a drawing, and I hate presenting, and I hate speaking about the work because drawings are much more eloquent than words. But I've been really moved by the words and the work of Parla, and I see you had Justine and Naomi here several weeks ago, and their work in trying to break through the stereotypes about who people in architecture are and what they do. And so I was, you know, got Sue-Ann's email thinking, oh God, I can't do that. I don't even run a practice for starters. I'm not a director or a partner or an associate. I'm not even a registered architect, so please bear that in mind when I use the A word this evening. But in the spirit of the conversation that Parla started, I sort of took a deep breath and thought I'd have a go at adding a tentative squeak into the wilderness tonight. And also because I believe it's really possible to make a considered and thoughtful contribution to this thing called architecture without having your name on the door of a practice. and that actually most people working in architecture are probably exactly like me. Now, I do really hate speaking because writing is much more my thing, so I've written some words and I've got that terrible quote from Gore Vidal in my head where he skewers people like me who read speeches and look up from time to time to create the illusion of spontaneity. But, so I'll apologise in advance for that, but bear with me, so hopefully I'll warm up. So my beginning. So I was born in Sydney in Darlinghurst, and I spent the early years of my life way out here in Western Sydney in a 1970s subdivision to the northwest of Blacktown, and it was a pretty raw environment. The suburb was just being built when we were growing up there, and our playgrounds were building sites, some timber building frames on brilliant orange red Western Sydney clay. But interestingly enough, I now live about two blocks away from where I was born, and I work about 15 minutes walk away from that, so I think that says something. And even back then, I kind of knew or sensed when I was living in Western Sydney that I was sort of living in an in-between part of the Sydney experience. And when our relatives visited from overseas, we proudly took them to these two other worlds that were sort of these magnetic forces, east and west of where we lived, the city and the mountains. And it was like a sort of pilgrimage every time we ventured there. And I've got such a strong childhood memory of seeing either the silhouette of the city or the blue mountains on my skyline as a child. And even to this day, when I'm in the very far eastern part of Sydney and I look down the harbour to the city, I get kind of a jolt because that city feels back to front. And I shared this not to, you know, humiliate myself with photos of me as a young child, but I think it's quite interesting, or it's been interesting to reflect on the fact that in my day-to-day work as an architect, these are the two worlds I absolutely exclusively inhabit. And I've had about one project in Western Sydney in the entire 20 years that I work. And it's in a huge, enormous part of Sydney, which is completely undervalued. And I just wonder also whether some of my reservations or my feelings of being a bit of a fringe player in architecture also date from this sort of living in this sort of in-between world in my city in the early days. And also why I've titled my talk tonight Through the Looking Glass, because a lot of the time I do feel like I've just sort of slipped into this parallel universe. But the outsider's gaze, I think, both in architecture and in criticism particularly, I think can be a really valuable one. So the first thing I'm supposed to show you is my first built work, which is supposed to be a renovation I did for my parents or family when I was at uni. But as I just sort of alluded to, I grew up in Western Sydney and there's just not money for that kind of thing and it just doesn't happen. And the second thing I'm supposed to show you is the cute little derelict terrace that I bought just after uni. But that I've renovated in spectacular fashion with a brilliant kitchen. But I don't own a house, and I suspect if things keep tracking the way they are, I probably never will. And I share this again not to sort of indulge in a small group therapy session this evening, but I suspect that this is a story that's going to become increasingly normal. And I suspect that most of you in this room will be carrying far greater university debts than I did and have a much tougher time in the housing market than I ever have. And I think it's important to acknowledge and discuss the reality of these sorts of things and hopefully understand them and change them in our lifetime. But the one big upside is it gets through the early part of my talk really quickly. So I studied at Sydney and I completed studies in 98, but in fourth year I started working at Hill Thalis. And so Sydney Uni was structured so you had a year off in fourth year between. We had two separate degrees and it was a really useful time because it was a really important moment for pause and reflection. You had a sort of general design education and you could have a moment to sort of travel and work and decide whether you really wanted to commit to the full degree. And I did a short stint of work with an architect called Ted Alexander and Stephen Collier, who you might have heard of. And awfully, Ted had a massive heart attack one weekend and he died really suddenly just after I'd been working with him for a couple of months. And so I travelled with some urban projects that we were working on to an architect called Russell Olson, who had his desk next to Philip Thalis in a little studio in Riley Street. And Philip asked if I could do a bit of drawing for him after hours as things were getting quite busy for him because he just started his practice and things were starting to burgeon. And 21 years later, I'm still sitting there. So this is also pretty atypical in the scheme of things, I think. I'm supposed to have either left and worked at multiple practices or shown some temerity and begun a practice of my own, which is the most asked question I get. But there's several reasons why I haven't done that. And first is the great diversity of work that Hill Thalis actually undertakes. In my time there, I've worked on everything from designing large and small parts of the city, subdivisions, apartment buildings, houses, granny flats, alternates, shop fit-outs, heritage work, bridges, one tree house and two cubbies. And the diversity of projects has been one of the most important parts of my learning in architecture, and I've just been really wonderfully lucky to have them all in one place. And the second reason I've stayed is is the practice's ethical stance, I suppose. And this is critically important because we operate predominantly in the pretty hardcore terrain of housing, urban projects and public space. And these projects involve questions about the tension between development and the democratic, you know, basis of the city. And we consider it our professional obligation to act in the public interest and for the public good at all times. And so more often than we'd like, that puts us into situations of conflict with lots of authorities whose role is actually to be in the public interest, but there's very little evidence of that these days in Sydney. And the practice's ethical stance and independent viewpoints obviously underpinned by Hill Thalis, who you probably all know, and his ethics, but more importantly his courage and his just complete compulsion to act on it continues to amaze and, I must admit, terrify me after all this time. He's got an encyclopedic knowledge of city and housing types, and it's been a real privilege and a great source of learning to me to work with somebody like that for such a long time. But the only downside of having worked for someone like that is they talk and lecture a lot. So if any of you have seen his lectures, you've probably seen all my best material. But he does this shtick when he speaks about the work of the practice, where he gives this huge rundown of all the things we do, and he says, oh, I'm not going to talk about these houses and stuff. So I thought I might actually show some of the Hill Thalis B-sides tonight that don't get so much of an airing. But with one important exception, which, because I have to spend the first few minutes on one of the things that Philip talks about a lot, which is Barangaroo. And I need to do this because Sue Ann's list of provocations had key learning outcomes on it, and basically Barangaroo was one giant key learning outcome. We started working on this competition in 2005 as a collaboration of Jane Owen and Paul Bergmar Architects, and we were shortlisted as one of five entries to proceed to a second stage competition, and it was an incredibly intense period, very long hours, lots of tension. The competition had cost us a huge amount of money because Hill Thalis pays every staff member for every hour of their time. There's no unpaid overtime in our office. We had a huge team of consultants giving us advice, and we had expensive models and a short film to make. So it was really quite ridiculous. And so it's just important to say for the record that I think when we won the Stage 2 competition, we'd won about $250,000 worth of prize money, and we'd made a loss on that. So when we won Stage 2, it was pretty exciting and quite a whirlwind kind of moment. And I didn't get to go to the competition announcement because it was only for A-listers. But they had a second evening where all the, you know, the hoi polloi could come along. And so that was held in a room as a podium of the Opera House, and it had all the boards and models of the five finalists up on display. And it didn't take very long to see how this whole story was going to end, because I remember seeing Paul Keating using our model as a tray table for his champagne glass while he took all the dignitaries on a tour of the Richard Rogers scheme, which was next to ours. And look, a lot's been said about this project, and it isn't really the place to rehash all of that, but there are a couple of really tremendously important things that I learned from this experience. And the first is that if you work for nothing or for very little money, that people will treat your work and your advice as if it's worth what they paid for it. So, you know, basically they'll treat it like it's worth bugger all. And competitions are incredibly problematic for a number of reasons, but this is a big one. We shouldn't work for nothing or for very little money unless it's pro bono work for critically important community housing or social groups who don't have the finances to be able to access our services. But that's not who architects work for free for. We do it for developers. We do it for the richest councils, authorities and institutions in our country. And these are the last people we should be donating our services to. They profit off our work and they can afford to pay us. And so we must not work for nothing or for discounted rates unless it's addressing a legitimate charitable need. It's a big thing I've discovered. And the second thing is that I think architects are pretty underprepared for the real attacks that are being made on the urban realm and our cities now. And I'm not talking about terrorism, I'm talking about development and the corporate culture. In looking back over the entries to the East Darling Harbour competition, there's very few that appeared to make a distinction between city making and just inflating architecture. And one architect, who I will be charitable and not name, said in relation to our scheme that it wasn't really a scheme, it was just a subdivision plan. And I thought that that totally exposed the mentality of a lot of the profession about this sort of work, because they just see it as a chance to do big architecture. But there are really critically important civic and democratic questions at play before even architecture even comes into the picture. So this was the drawing of our plan of Barangaroo, and it was entirely focused on making a civic kind of public domain structure that facilitated an evolving city. And we wanted the scheme to just bleed into the city so that the boundaries of the site were completely invisible. And ever since this time, in the large redevelopment projects in our city at Barangaroo and in Darling Harbour, which is the cove south of that, Buildings have come first, and the public realm has come second, and it's just sort of fitted in around them. And so the architectural tail is kind of wagging the urban dog. And cities don't last if you make them this way. So Exhibit 1's Darling Harbour, right next to Barangaroo. Version 1 lasted 20 years. An absolute epic failure in terms of city making. And we not only repeated this at Barangaroo, right next door, we also repeated it again at Darling Harbour when we've torn it down and rebuilt it and made all of the same mistakes within our living memory. Now, you won't be really concerned about that if you're a multinational building corporation, because it's pretty great, actually, to think that you might have large chunks of the city which you get to remake every 20 years. It's pretty good for your cash flow. But in an era of great pressures on cities, affordability, homelessness, people sleeping in this building next door, climate change, we should be utterly horrified and humiliated by this gross waste and inefficiency, not to mention the sort of cultural sterility that this suggests about a way of city making, which says we care so little about our city that we're happy for its mode of renewal to be predicated on, like making large parts of it disposable. So the other important discovery on this project was that the most important drawing ever for Barangaroo wasn't made by an architect, it was made by a lawyer. And this drawing sat in the back of the Barangaroo Delivery Authority Act, and it was made in 2009, which was 4 years after the competition. And this is the drawing which set out what the public interest was. This was the drawing which set out the lands that had been reserved for public use. And so you'll see down in the legend there's two, it's a bit fuzzy, but there's blue and yellow. So blue is the Barangaroo Headland Park, and the yellow is public domain. And the little note underneath that says, no public domain identified at time of signing. And there was actually, there had been our master plan, there had been a sort of bastardised version of it which had gone into the planning documents, full of streets, lanes, a suite of hierarchy of smaller parks, larger parks, and none of it was put in this document, which was signed by the Minister, Christina Keneally, in 2009. So here you go. The drawing in the back of the Act is the one that speaks the truth. This was the instruction that government, you know, the defenders of our public interest, gave to the people bidding on the site, open slather for development, whatever you want. While critics, journalists and everybody else in the profession were arguing about whether the edge should be straight or curved or whether the architecture was kind of pretty enough. Public land given away, no protection. And Phillips roundly criticised for continuing to speak about Barangaroo because people accusing him of sort of nursing very hurt feelings. But trust me, that's not why he does it. We've seen the documents, we've been in the meetings, we've seen how this works, and we've seen it three times now. He's seen it three times at Olympic Village, at Darling Harbour and Barangaroo. So he actually just can't abide that this has happened in our city four times in his working life on our watch. And he continues to speak because we've got to learn from this. And I'm incredibly conscious that I'm speaking tonight in Newcastle, you know, this incredible urban place between the harbour and the ocean with the most beautiful structure, draped over dramatic topography, a plethora of extraordinary building stock in the city, and they've already taken your train line and they're working over your harbour front and they're circling for what's next. And so it's your job to defend this stuff because it really matters. And it's important to fight, but it's also important not to become embittered, and this can be really difficult. You actually sort of need to develop a kind of split personality. Part of you sharpens your cynicism and your ability to fear the worst so that you're sort of ready and prepared when you need to fight. And the other part of you has to feed your optimism so that even the context of all this mess, you can sit down and pour your heart out through a pencil or a mouse into architecture every day. So architecture is where we head now. So my first project was a six-storey building, which I like to say, but admittedly I am cheating a bit because it did only have a 45 square metre footprint. And so it was 5 metres by 9 metres in dimension. So substation 175 is that tiny little red square there. It was completed in 2005, and just up the road, Studios 54 was completed in 2014. And so both were for the same client, interestingly enough, a builder-developer called the Trinium Group. And so we like to say that these projects are separated by about 10 years and 100 metres. So Substation 175 is a kind of miracle of sorts, because firstly it was a housing project in the city that didn't go to court. There was no resident petition, we didn't get assaulted at a council meeting. In fact, the DA for that didn't even go up to a full meeting of council. And it was our client's first development site. The building dated from 1925 and it held transformers for the city's power supply, and it had a little pocket park to the west of it. And being such a tiny site, this building acquired this kind of lovely architectural character of basically having a room per floor. So it was stratified vertically. It has a small shop on the ground floor, and then it runs living room, sleeping room, and then separates to the next apartment, where you get sleeping room, living room, and working room. And the site was so small that obviously there was no room for a lift, and so the stair became sort of a really important component of the building. We had to just test all these kind of various options, and you can just see how much of the site they actually took. So there were many initial tests for efficiency because space was critical, but that later morphed into a much more interesting architectural idea about how you might make a daily walk up five flights of stairs an engaging experience rather than a sort of grueling and demeaning one. So the lower apartment in the old brick shell of the substation sort of evolved as a concrete frame to stiffen the structure for the earthquake code, and because it was pre-basics, we were allowed to keep a pivoting window and some of the original painted brickwork of the substation. The upper floors were construction steel just for speed, and they all had to be clad for fire rating, so the structure wasn't present in the same way, so we just used a range of materials like meshes and Pirelli rubber just to try and evoke that sort of former industrial sensibility. And the upper apartment used to be lived in by this great graphic designer who was ex-New York, and she told us she loved living there because she loved the stairs because they were great for your buns. We love statistics about housing, so when we complete projects, we draw them, we measure them, and we place them into this sort of atlas that we develop. And it's incredibly helpful for us to benchmark the performance of our work. And it's nice, I quite like the image of it too, because that sort of shows you that the work of all of the individuals in our practice becomes this much larger and important thing, which is sort of much more than the sum of its parts. And when I co-edited with Philip an issue of Architecture Australia in 2014, we also used this method of analysis to compare the projects we included in that issue, because it sort of helps to cut through the more slippery quality of words, because drawing and measurements have a much harder time of evading uncomfortable truths. The most impressive little statistic in our atlas for this building is that with two apartments, the occupants have the choice of 38 operable sashes to control their ventilation. And this is still a record we haven't broken in any subsequent apartment. And obviously it's a characteristic of the very small one room per floor model. Major facade face west onto the pocket park, and so we use this sort of language of the big red blinds as almost like an urban semaphore. And on the Devonshire Street side, which I haven't got a photograph of because it's really impossible to photograph because it's really tight, it had this beautiful brick facade. And so we just used mesh balconies and inset windows just to, in quite subtle ways, manipulate the scale relationships of the proportions to the elements below. So it's a zinc addition on top, so it's stridently kind of contemporary, but making some scale relationships with that older building. And what interested us most about this building was the way that it was able to intensify the urbanity of this little place in such a small area. And we felt that there's a really similar opportunity on the site up the hill at Studios 54 those years later. So 10 years later, the approval process was much less of a miracle. The approval got snagged in city politics. The site, you had two terrace houses on it, which were very low quality, weren't heritage listed, but as the application went up to council, one of the councillors got a bee in a bonnet about them and argued that the two terraces should stay, even though council's own heritage expert had led them on a tour of the building and showed them that the only two remaining original elements were one window sill plinth and one piece of balustrade on one level. At this stage, I should probably say that all my comments tonight are strictly my own and don't necessarily reflect the view of recently elected City of Sydney Councillor Philip Zalas, who would probably be quite horrified that I'm telling you that story. This site was much bigger, so it was 126 square metres, so still not large, but much bigger than the other one. And this time we had a short facade to west and a long facade to the lane, to this side lane here. And the fact that it was a publicly owned lane was what made this building possible. Otherwise, there would have been absolutely no way to get egress, fire boosters, hydrants, disabled access to the garbage room off the lift, which council required, and a commercial frontage and building entry to work together. And in fact, I'm really sad to say that due to the exponential increase in the kind of regulation about all of these things in building codes, there's no way I'll be showing you a third one of these in 10 years' time, because this one was really at the limit of the possible. In two areas of this plan, it was the intent 20 mil of not working at all. And if you know what builders are up against these days, 20 mil's kind of tough. And it's quite a shame, because none of these codes intentionally set out to make this sort of thing very difficult to do, but cumulatively that is their effect. And so it's a really beautiful little sort of urban model. So when we started construction on this site, the Angelo Candelapis building just on the left-hand side of the screen there had just started construction, and on the southern side there's a heritage listed pub, and at the back of it, it had this little beer garden with this fantastically popular lane, so it was very, very, very noisy. So the planning of the apartment, we biased very particularly to these conditions, so we just made this really thick and defensive wall of services that ran between it and the pub. And so that just made this very long tube of space that ran from front to back through the plan. So light and air are possible from the front and the back, and light with fire-protected drenched openings are possible and onto this little laneway because it's not 6 metres. But we still get light in there because we get light or air wherever we can. The unusual thing that we did was we separated the fire stairs from the lift, so you can see that square at the back there. And that was because there's a really odd kink in the site geometry, which meant with the fire offsets, we couldn't get any opening windows near the back of the site. And so the internalised kind of fire stairs seemed to actually be well placed there. But the funny thing was that this meant that the entry to each apartment became this kind of philosophical discussion about the building code as to what a front door is, because a front door is required to have a fire rating, and a lift door is unable to achieve the fire rating under the building code. So thankfully we had a BCA advisor and certifier who were happy to accept that the spirit of the code was that the front door was the door separating you from the fire escape where you needed to run if there was a fire. But it was pretty fascinating that such a simple idea about entering the building onto a balcony ended up became this incredibly radical thing, because the building code just anticipates that you'll always enter an apartment off a common hallway that's inside. And these spaces are some of the nicest parts of the apartments, as they're really eclectically inhabited and personalised. And someone in the green apartment at the moment has two pink plastic pelicans on their balcony, which is really quite super. I need to go and get a picture of it. And this is an aspect of working on multiple housing that's really interesting, because there isn't an owner and we don't know who will be living in these apartments, so we don't craft a bespoke interior that's, you know, individualised, and we make a much more neutral armature that can be tailored by individuals. But you can't leave everything being totally generic, because the building has to offer something to the life and vitality of the city. So in this instance, we were again facing west, so we used those coloured blinds and lots of tiny little signature elements in the facade here. There's some coloured glass in the stairwell, and just in these inset porches, you can get a sense there's these very brightly coloured black walls that just put a little wash of colour into that back courtyard there. So they just sort of offset this much more neutral and monolithic character of render and vitro panel. And occasionally the city responds back. This is a woman who was on her hen's night who happened to be passing when Brett Boardman, who's responsible for all the photographs I'll show you tonight, was shooting the building, and her sombrero just was the most brilliant match to the colour scheme. But not everything is architecture. So when you don't spend all your time in architecture making buildings, there is some teaching, which is exhausting but amazingly rewarding. And then I've also spent some time writing and critiquing buildings, so I thought it'd be interesting to talk a little bit about writing about architecture rather than drawing it. I'm particularly glad I've done it, because now we're embroiled in this sort of world of social media where everyone has an instant opinion or a quip or a takedown, and writing about architecture formally for journals and newspapers demands a much different level of engagement. Making public comments about architecture is a really serious business, and there's nothing more there's nothing like the moment of opening Architecture Australia or The Guardian and seeing your own words coming back out of you that really focuses your mind on the seriousness with which you should kind of take this endeavour. And I'm really grateful for the opportunity it's afforded me to develop a way of approaching architecture that extends my intellectual thinking about it, and it's not. So the way I respond to buildings when I write about them is not simply how closely it resembles what I would have done or how I would have approached that building. And I think that distance is important, because that's what makes the opinion critical in the intellectual sense. And it's also something that a lot of people find quite difficult nowadays, where criticism becomes sort of reflexive, I don't like that or I wouldn't have done that. There are a few myths to bust about writing. Everyone assumes that architects are really pompous and drag you around their buildings and telling you about how fabulous they are, but actually more often than not they're so embedded in the work and racked with doubt that pretty much every interview becomes an architect guided defects tour. Oh, did you see that? Oh, look what they did there. Oh my God, the client left that out. You know, so on and so on. I've never had work censored or an opinion altered in the entire time I've written. There's regularly instances where you're taken into confidence by architects and you're told things that you cannot print. But of course they inform the opinion, and when relevant, we're presuming that you're being really active readers, and so we'll leave tiny crumbs between the lines for you to follow. There are a few myths, unfortunately, I can verify. There are lots of people in this industry with access to Grind, and people will let you know in no uncertain terms when you have said something nice about somebody they dislike. If they go to the trouble to let you know, it usually reveals more about them than the subject of the review. Negative reviews are almost universally well received. Writing in a compelling way about why architecture is successful or why it's moved or provoked you in some way is much more difficult, and it rarely elicits the same kind of passion or reaction that the negative reviews do. Women writing about architecture in an emotional or descriptive way is still tends to be viewed as being lightweight and not very serious kind of criticism, and I just sort of think, well, so be it about that, because I remain very interested in the use of architectural description as a way of conveying the emotional content or import of architecture, and I can't imagine writing about buildings without attempting to record that in some way. And I personally, one of the exquisite joys for me about writing is selecting particular words and a tone and a kind of tempo that somehow almost subliminally or imperceptibly kind of conveys this kind of sensibility that resonates being within the building itself. And I'd really like I'm having a little break from writing at the moment, but when I get back into it, I'd really like to have a good think about how to write about excellent work really well in a way that's able to elicit the same kind of response. And it's not to say that you shouldn't criticise or you shouldn't be critical and everything should be, you know, that you should always be glowing. But the critical gaze, I think, cuts both ways, and I think if culture's working well, it should. So we should be able to do both. I've only ever had two complaints about articles, and one which wasn't pulled but was published with a separate companion essay at the request of the dissatisfied subject of the review. Interestingly enough, they were all from the same creative field and gender. They weren't architects, believe it or not, but you probably won't be surprised to hear that they weren't women either. If people approach you to write, it's an extremely worthwhile thing to do, and I'd really encourage you to do it. Every editor I've ever worked with has told me how bad architects are at writing, and I think we collectively do need to get better at this. But as with the competitions, you can't write for free. Architectural criticism should be a full-time job, and it's not anymore. No one could be a full-time architectural critic on what writing pays. And their job is really important to us and to our discipline. So if we're part-timing it, we really have to be careful not to undercut them and diminish their work further. But we started with the two distant worlds of my childhood. So I sewn you some city projects, but I've also been lucky enough to work on two projects that shared a landscape. So that's where we move now. As an architect, you sort of learn to wear many, or a building designer, not a registered architect, you learn to wear many different hats. So one of these projects is on an escarpment in a mountainous valley, and the other one is on the point where that system meets the ocean. So first we'll go to the mountains. So in the city, with its kind of dazzling cacophony of elements, there's so much that starts to push and prompt into a prod about how you site a building and anchor its form. And the landscape is really so much more serene, it too is obviously infinitely rich, but its cues are much more subtle. And I remember hearing this amazing talk by Teresa Moller, the incredible landscape architect, when she was in Australia. And she gave a talk called Walk the Line. And I'll just actually quote a little bit of that talk, where she said, "I always have this obsession with lines in the landscape. Everything makes lines, and it works because there is nothing else. You put the line in the middle of all this wildness, and all the wildness becomes more aware of the line and the line of the wildness. It's a contrast that brings more power to both things. The line is a subject in itself." And in our landscape-based projects, we too are very interested in this idea of the line, but we don't physically walk the line. It's one that our eyes walk. So the mountainside house is an astonishing place. Astonishingly sensitive client who spent months and months clearing his site of blackberry with his sister every weekend. And so he had this incredibly intimate understanding of the site's microclimate, which was very particular. It's got an incredible outlook. So to the north, it looks onto this basanite escarpment, which looks like that. And to the east, it opens towards the ocean. And so between these two landscape elements, we found our line, which was this one point where the verticality of the escarpment broke and the horizon became the powerful dominant line. And so we anchored the axis of the house to that point. And the house is arranged in two really simple bands. There's a north band with all the living spaces and a southern band with sleeping and bathing spaces. And then this clarity is enlivened by the relationship of this really serene thing to topography. So long axes through the house look back from this kind of cutting landscape architect. So they go from, landscape courtyard to the much more expansive, which is very earthbound, to these much more expansive views, which are up and held above the landscape. And there's, so it has this incredible prospect. And the cross axis that runs along the contour where the building lands firmly looks from valley to valley, so the scale comes in and it's pinched in this incredibly emphatic concrete knuckle in the middle of the house. And we're really interested in this sense of solidity and depth, which again is it's a little bit unusual in Australian architecture in these sorts of environments. And perhaps this comes from the large amount of time we spend working in the city where we need to withdraw and we're interested in ideas of privacy. And here in these landscapes, you obviously don't need to do that, but the depth of a threshold's a really powerful thing. And it frames things so emphatically. So we like to balance moments where the outlooks are really sweeping and epic and you're on the very edge and face of the building with much smaller moments when you're pulled right off the face that sort of edit and condense the site into smaller pieces. So there's this series of really strong axial and linear views to the house which are articulated with soft finishes with timber and this polished plaster which has this incredibly light surface, so it sort of reflects these views right into the middle of the body of the house. And of course that's contrasted then with, you know, the polar views, the tangential views that slice through the plan from outside to inside and outside again, so that the building's not only framing internal but it's framing external space as well. And this thickness on the edge of the building was particularly important in this project, as our client had two particular passions. One was his piano, because he's an exceptional musician, and his piano occupies the elevated room on the front of the house, which is like the dreaming room. And his other passion was his garden, and in all honesty, he spends more time there than he does inside the house. And he's got half of which the garden is sort of working with bush region, and half of it he's making this incredible cultivated garden around the house, which is sort of wildly cultivated and colourful and scented. And he worked on this with Jane Irwin, landscape architect, and he and his sister built all of these random stone walls just piece by piece over many, many weekends. So given the amount of time he spent outside the house, these thicknesses all around the edge of the building make this kind of suite of porches and ledges and promontories that offer occupiable space to the outside, which, as I said, he uses more than the house up, I think. And so there's some which are elevated, some which are earthbound. And so there's a great range of these types of spaces around the dwelling. And this beautiful stone that Jane had cut to make a little step to the house. And to my last project, which is hilarious because it began in 2001 and is just a squeak away from completion now. So your maths are right, it's been 16 years. But I wanted to finish on this one because there's been lots of difficulty and strife in projects like Barangaroo when you're fighting in those very contested public works. But sometimes things have a happy ending. So this site is also extraordinary. It's a cattle farm. And the lot runs from the highway to the water. And our first client, we had three clients on this project, two amazing women and one really formidable man. And the first client was a very strong and determined woman, and as it transpired, she really needed to be. She wanted to make a retreat here for her family. She'd had a long attachment to this area because she'd holidayed here as a child and she owned several farms in the district. So on this amazing site, you can just probably read there's just a little notch in the primary, the lot just follows the spine right down to the water, so there's just a little notch there. So the first site that we looked at the house was where we just thought we might be able to just tuck it in with some kind of discretion. But as often happens to us, things got a bit more complicated. Council, the Department of Planning, and a body called the Coastal Council became involved in the application for this dwelling, and they all set out their criteria for where the house should be, which basically left no options at all, and the client actually had the entitlement to build three houses on this site. And as it worked out, as we worked through the politics of it, which was very time-consuming, the Coastal Council really had the greatest weight, so they won, and their criteria at the end of the day was that the house should be as far away from the ocean as possible, which meant that they agreed that the house could sit on top of the hill, where we'd said to our client, don't even bother trying to get the house approved up there. It's way too prominent. They'll never let you. What would we know? Eventually, this house ended up being designated as state significant development and was signed off by the Minister for Planning. So this house had the same planning status as Barangaroo, but seemingly a few more hurdles because we weren't allowed to write our own rules here. Bushfires, vibration from the railway, you name it, they threw it at our poor client. But anyway, I mean, she was delighted. She had this new position on the top of the hill that had panoramic views north-south to these incredible townships. And then we found that the one site that they'd agreed on was traversed by 3 Telstra optic fibre lines. And we had a map of these that said on it had an accuracy of about plus or minus 12 metres. So we had to get these exposed and surveyed, which took months and months, because we figured out that actually cutting this cable would result in a cost of about $1 million a minute in damages. And nobody on the planet had enough insurance to cover any incident with them. So, and interesting enough, these things don't have easements, so they don't show up on your title searches. They only show up on when you do your dial before you dig plans, and they just sit in a little bit of flex pipe, about 300 mil. They just run a backhoe down the farms and put them through. It's incredible. So there were years and years of this nonsense before I start. And she started building in 2006, and she was so sick of waiting that she employed a builder to run the works, and we were documenting just as he was starting to build, which we thought was a terrible idea. I mean, we were issuing drawings saying for construction up to RL 111.5. This big line on the drawing. But in hindsight, it was really fortuitous that she did this, because if she hadn't started then, it actually wouldn't have happened at all, because the project had been on site for about 18 months. It was about 2 pieces of glass away from rock up, and this series of really awful personal tragedies beset our client, and she had to stop work on the house. And so we'd lived and breathed this job for 6 years, and it just stopped dead. And the house actually sat dormant for 10 years. And then in 2006, she made the heartbreaking decision to sell it. And you can imagine that selling an incomplete house is not a great economic move. So she really tried hard to keep it, but she had to let it go. And then we really thought it was dead and buried. And then we got an email from the couple who'd purchased the property, and they wanted to meet. So we were so nervous when they came in, and we tried to put up this incredibly brave and calm professional demeanour, but about 20 minutes in we just said, oh my god, please let us finish it. No, like, and they have been the most delightful clients to work with. They're incredibly private, so I'll be lynched if I tell you anything about them, but I have to tell you that their passion for the project, their bravery in taking risks for quality, and their long-standing interest in contemporary architecture, art and furniture just really meant that they felt like our collaborators rather than just our clients on this project. So to our lines. Well, here we had the horizon, the most beautiful line of all. So you approach the house from above, and everything's been set to ensure that the form is entirely below the water on approach. But we found 2 other lines that also helped us to anchor the project. I don't know if you can see that very clearly. So the house is that little dot in the middle of those 2 yellow lines. So the cross one is that runs through the centre of the house is where we found a line that linked the main streets of the 2 adjacent towns, which are planted with these quite characteristic and very strong rows of very tall pine trees. And then this, obviously, this third really strong line that came through the centre of the house, just where that incredible escarpment system all the way from the other house comes and lands at the water. And now there's 3 wings, and it's quite simply planned. So the eastern side facing the water holds all the living spaces, and the north facing wing holds the client's suite where they live, and the south wing holds the guest rooms, which are predominantly used in summer. So these, and you can see the 2 axes, so the much smaller axis is that one that links the 2 towns, and the one that comes through the courtyard and is then framed out to the ocean is that one, is that more land axis. And we framed these 2 sort of axes quite differently in proportion in the house. So the one that frames the 2 towns is always framed vertically, and it contrasts with the horizontal one, which foreshortens on this angular geometry as it moves through the courtyard and comes into this much more contained and blinkered space with concrete walls, and then opens back up again into CinemaScope, sort of in the eastern rooms, and then bends very slightly on the outside edge, a little bit like a sort of a meniscus on the edge of the glass, just acknowledging that final powerful point of encounter with the horizon. And then in the corner living rooms, we're able to be much more curatorial about the way we can frame and capture particular moments within sort of emphatic kind of steel and concrete frames. And for those of you who are looking carefully, no, you're not seeing things. Those floorboards are that wide. The largest one was 1 meter wide by 10 meters in length. And we had this incredible craftsman, Norby, who came and laid this floor for us while we just all crossed our fingers. But it's perfect, it hasn't moved at all. But it's so important that the experience of a site like this isn't diluted by overexposure. So in the day-to-day living through the house, you always have to return to the courtyard for this sense of respite and intimacy, and I guess just to almost reset your sense of the site. And when you do that, you pass through these incredibly deep, thick, sculpted concrete niches. And I mean, I guess in a weird kind of way, it's a little bit like slipping through the looking glass, but just a very heavy concrete one. And this thickness is, it holds space for these very beautiful birds, which were made by an artist called Anna Willie Highfield, which are black-shouldered kites, which, and they're actually life-size, and you occasionally see them flying around the site, which is quite beautiful. And we trim the tie rod holes with black mother-of-pearl discs that are quite similar to the quality of the mussel shells that you'll find on the local beach. And so you move through these frames back into this much more tranquil kind of courtyard space. And this courtyard, which has these grass trees, which just are constantly sort of shimmering and bristling in the wind. And we this is another one where we said, oh, they're never going to last, you can't put those there, and they're incredibly happy. Never give advice. And then they shut down again to the bedrooms, which are much more contained. And those paintings, which the believe it or not, the owners had been collecting for years before they even kept eyes on this property. And to the bathroom spaces, which are planned on enfilade, which means in these long lines. So everything's always moving away from you, and you're just presented with these incredibly precise pieces of the site. And we kept the bathrooms entirely grey because the blue and the greens of the site were so intense that we just used this polished plaster and this grey marble, so that it was like the interiors were almost monochrome and the landscape was technicolour. And while we were detailing the building, the exterior elements, we were looking at this amazing book that Philip has called Paris, Rome, Athens, which has all these drawings from the students of the Beaux-Arts who won the Prix de Rome scholarship. And they used to travel to ancient sites, and they had to meticulously document the ruins. And then they had to produce a drawing of a reconstruction of the site. And they're them the most incredible drawings. They're sort of the most incredible acts of architectural imagination. And this is a piece of the Parthenon which we were looking at because of the siding on the top of the hill, we were really drawn to these ideas of very elemental pieces in architecture, of sort of columns and entablatures and friezes and what they might mean now, and that incredible three-dimensionality of ancient corners. And we felt like we were getting a bit above ourselves looking at the Parthenon as the inspiration for a house, but when it started construction, we were pretty glad we had. And what I most like about the project is the way that it sits really resolutely and quite silently in the site, and it just sort of feels like the world and the weather just sort of rolls over you. And the site actually does have these repeatedly occurring rainbows that run from cove to cove on either side of the headland, and to the point where a friend of mine was on site, he accused me of setting them on the iPad, like at the Truman Show. But I assure you I don't. And so you just, the shadow of the clouds just kind of rolls along the paddocks, and you just keep moving back to these incredibly intimate kind of parts of the building, and in this sort of hortus conclusus, and then back out into this kind of epic landscape. So after 21 years in practice, I was just thinking, oh God, what have I learned? So I just did 10 kind of points, and probably not 10. So I've learned to keep my cynicism sharp, but on a very tight leash. And I've learnt never to put the cynicism into the work, just to the nonsense that surrounds the work. I've learnt to top up my reservoir of optimism at every opportunity, because it's almost always most needed when it's in the shortest of supply. It's important to work hard. Architecture is difficult and time consuming, but you've got to be really careful not to martyr yourself to it. Every work of architecture involves the work of hundreds of people, and they're all critical. There is nothing that is unimportant. You have to say no when you need to, but you have to be ready to duck quickly. And lastly, I guess, the collective work of architects and designers and landscape architects and artists and engineers makes this thing we call the city. And we really have to research it and analyse it and know it and dream it and cherish it, because we're its custodians for the short time that we are working, and it evolves ceaselessly after we're gone. And if we're lucky, our work remains, but the myriad authors of it are just a mere footnote. So, thank you.